IMFE to talk about in terms of how can we engage Jamaicans and find out where are we with regard to financial literacy. We talk about financial literacy, we're talking about three pillars. We're talking about knowledge, we're talking about behavior, and we are talking about attitude. And we are going to present the findings under those headings. So we develop a baseline study similar to 14 countries across four continents. That's to say that what we did, we adopted and adapted the instrument that they use. And of course, what that would do is for us to be able to compare. Yes? And we determine one measure of financial literacy that can provide rational or national benchmarks. Define levels of financial literacy to enable policymakers to identify needs and gaps. And of course, provide a basis for comparison across the country. In the way we went about design and execution of the study, we adopted, as we indicated, and adapted the instrument. We piloted the pilot study within Kingston, St. Andrew area to kind of take out the kinks, what question might be misinterpreted and all of that. And then we engaged students from tertiary institutions, from UWE, from UTEC, from the teachers' colleges, from NCU right across, and we try to identify students who could go into each of the parishes. Then we did a stratified sample. Essentially what we did, we divide the entire country based on parish, then we divide based on capitals, then we divide based on major towns and minor towns. And the sample size was 1,000. That was more than would have been necessary. Just to tell you that the US has over 300 million, and when they do survey, they need no more than 1,200. For those who are not in statistics, that might be so frightening. Data collected over 2 to 3 weeks in July 2012, and then after that we have a debriefing session. All right, some of the findings. Main findings with regard to financial knowledge. Now, financial knowledge has to do with, for example, suppose I came to you and said, okay, fine, I gave you $500. And at the end of, say, 2 months, how much then do you have if the interest rate was, say, 10%? Yes? Another question we asked that you have $10,000, five of you brothers, what would you get if it's divided equally among you five? Right? So some of those would be knowledge. So financial literacy on Jamaicans comparable to other parts of the countries in some areas. In the area of financial knowledge, less than half of Jamaicans gain a high score, or what we say, to answer correctly based on what we deem to be correct answer. That is, right, 6 out of 8 rather. Jamaicans appear to have particular difficulties though with the concept of the value of money and identifying and indeed calculating the impact of interest, especially with regard to compound interest. And when I drilled down a little bit, based on my little knowledge of teaching math in high school, found that part of that might be tied to the idea of teaching simple interest rather than a concentration or some emphasis on compound interest. Yes? Indeed, I want to say that the financial institution in Jamaica seem to communicate simple interest rather, and then they charge compound interest and all of that. That needs to be, right? With regard to giving you a map in terms of financial knowledge, percentage score in 6 or more, just to start talking about. So when we compare with other countries, as you can see there, we favorably, we are Jamaica, of course, to be ought to be gold, let's show yellow, right? So we're not so bad off, after all. In fact, it was higher than I thought, right, given the anecdotal utterances and all of that in the space, in the public space. We're actually better than people would want us to think that we are. With regard to main findings, with regard to behavior with regard to how do we approach budgeting and credit card, use of credit card, approximately 60% of Jamaicans achieve a high score. Again, that compared favorably with other countries across the world and across the 14 countries to which a reference was made. Jamaicans are relatively good at setting long-term goals and engaging in active savings compared to other countries. Yes? So we set goals. Jamaicans seem relatively less skilled in short-term money management though, especially when it comes to monitoring personal financial affairs such as paying bills on time and avoiding use of credit to make ends meet. Yes? The point is that when it comes to I need some money to borrow because I'm hungry. I need to feed my children. They're gonna buy. And in order to buy, they are gonna borrow. Compared to the other countries, Dominicans appear to be relatively good at engaging in active saving. Again, inclination to save is actually higher than I thought, and at making some attempt at choosing financial product appropriately, at making an attempt, right? Now, when we compare that with other countries, as you're going to be seeing some comparison out of that, we're really not bad off after all. Responding in terms of being responsible, showing some kind of a financial responsibility, has a budget, say. This is what we observe. For example, we see Jamaica 38%, but we see Albania, Armenia, and all of that way above. And for example, Malaysia is 74%. But again, we are above what? Estonia, Germany, Hungary, and all of those countries. So what we found that Jamaicans generally, we make an attempt to have some kind of budget. Whether or not we stick to that budget, that's a different question. Yes? But we at least make an effort to have some kind of budget. Now, borrowing to make ends meet, when we look at the graph of this, we see that we are not the, the greatest borrowers, if you please, to make ends meet. Because when we look at people of Albania, Armenia, and all of that, those guys are greater borrowers than we are, right? And then what we see that we are 28%. Which is way above most of the other countries. So we got a bronze medal, yeah? All right, percentage scoring 6 or more in the behavioral space or perspective, we see that, again, 57% of the respondents actually came out high, as indicated, 60% of that. When we compare with the other countries, we're really not so bad again. When we look at the main findings with regard to attitude, approximately 50% of Jamaicans disagree with the statement. I find it more satisfying to spend money than to save it for a long term. That's a measure of attitude. Yes? When we look at the, with regard to 61% disagree with the statement, and by the way, these are the three basic statements that is used to measure attitude generally. 61% disagree with the statement, I tend to live for today and let tomorrow take care of itself. Including 44% of respondents disagree completely. So again, there is some level of responsibility with regard to attitude. And then we see from the findings, approximately 40% disagreed with the statement, money is there to be spent. Approximately 23% shows some disagreement, some ambivalence. We're not sure, if it's there to spend and all. So we're not yes or no, but, maybe. Now, when we now drill down in the data a little bit, a further analysis by the socio-demographic factors reveals that in contrast with most other countries, there are no gender differences in any of the three financial literacy components. That is to say, knowledge, behavior, and attitude. To me, this is a positive, yes? That is to say that we, in Jamaica, we seem to be allowing the information which is available to be equally distributed across gender. And sometimes when we have something which is good, we take it for granted. This, ladies and gentlemen, is a positive finding for Jamaica. The age profile of financial literacy is bell-shaped, that's to say normally distributed, with individuals age between the age range of 30 to 59 having a higher score compared to younger and older respondents. What that says to me is that more effort might need to be made to get in the primary schools and allow them to develop an attitude, good behavior with regard to money. I know that there's some savings thing there. Schools now, but we might need to make more deliberate effort doing that, and I see evidence of that certainly with the FSC making an effort to include and even going down to school, which is good. So both education, we found, and income are positively associated with overall financial literacy score. What that means is that we found that based on, and now we measure education based on certification. By that, I mean, if I, you might ask what level of education you have, and they might say college and university and so on, high school. So we are measuring one's education based on certification. And by the way, there's a difference. But one can be highly certified but not educated, yes? So if we measure, if we believe that that is so, so we are saying that the more educated you are, is the more inclined you will be to make better decisions with regard to knowledge and your behavior and attitude, you know, in terms of on the positive side. Not only that, but we found that persons who would fall more in the higher income bracket would actually be indicating that they have more knowledge. Yes? In financial matters, I would even be exhibiting a more positive behavior and attitude than those in the lower income bracket. And again, that is a gap that needs to be addressed by those who have that responsibility. We also found that there was some kind of relationship between behavior and knowledge. Again, and this is important because you know we can, one can have a knowledge of something, but the way you behave, right, there is no connection. For example, I'll give you a fine example. You find in Jamaica there are many of those who indicate that they are highly educated and the way they drive on the road is really not indicative of that, yes? And sorry if I step on any of the toes of people in here, right? So the literature often uses financial knowledge as a predictor of positive outcomes, yes? Which rely on behavior that are consistent with financial well-being. Exactly types of behaviors captured in what we're talking about here. The figure below, which is the next slide, shows that as in all other countries, Jamaica, there is a positive relationship between knowledge and behavior, all right? So, of course, the black line will indicate Jamaica, of which I do not apologize for the number, ladies and gentlemen, right? Indicative of us. Okay, so you see that there is a positive relationship between financial knowledge and behavior, all right? So what does that tell us? It might tell us that we need to make more effort to educate people, right, that they could be aware of what's happening in the knowledge part of their, in measuring literacy, and try to encourage them to allow the knowledge that they have to now be demonstrated, you know, they behave and so on and so forth, all right? And when we also have some information, it's also argued that those with positive attitudes towards the long term are more likely to behave in ways that are consistent with achieving long-term goals. So again, we have looked to see whether behavior scores increase with attitude scores. And what we saw here, Jamaica shows, as with other countries, a generally positive association between attitudes and behavior. People with attitudes that tend towards short-term gratification have lower behavior scores than those with an attitude score over 3. Yes? Now that has implication for those who are parents, that you ensure that you inculcate the need to wait until you can get before trying to go and try to maybe harass somebody to get it. Again, the graph shows this. And then, in terms of combined measures of financial literacy, we brought everything together now. Remember, you know, it's measured on 3 pillars: knowledge, behavior, and attitude. So we try to do a summary in a table here, compared with other countries. Again, we see here, with regard to high knowledge score, we see Jamaica with 47%, and we see, for example, Albania, Armenia, we see Norway, Peru, South Africa being below us, yes? And when we come with regard to high behavior score, we see Jamaica 57%, which again, we see those which are ahead of us and those below, and then high attitude, the score we see there, 63%, right? So we have some work to do, but we are not as way off as we, those in the media and in the street and all of that, will want to tell us. All right, so please believe in our data and do not always listen from the news from the north. All right, question and answer if anybody has any.
Professor.
Yes, I think the question will come after big one. All right, thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor. Very interesting indeed. Another hand for Dr. Lawrence Payne. People from time to time ask me if this next gentleman is my brother. I guess they notice resemblance in height. And of course, I say yes, but he got the money and I got the looks. Ladies and gentlemen, to present on a very hot and interesting topic, please welcome my big brother, Mr. Livingston Morris.
It was without hesitation that I accepted the invitation, simply because I see this particular topic, this area of focus, to be of tremendous importance in the continued growth and development of our nation. I have 15 minutes to speak on the topic electronic payment system, how it works. This is a very diverse audience, so I'm going to keep it simple and hope that the questions will allow me to expound a bit more on what can be a very complicated and interesting topic. How did I do? Okay. What is a payment? Why payment system matters? Why electronic payments? I'd like to speak a little bit about BOJ's interest in this area, and finally, how it works for you. By way of definition, a payment is a transfer of money or value from a payer to a payee to settle an obligation. I'd like to think that the simplest form of executing a payment is my passing cash over to you. Irrespective of the means by which we settle our obligations, payment exhibit a number of characteristics. A payer, somebody who has the obligation, money or value, and of course there's a means of transferring the value. And most importantly, the payee must be willing to accept the value in the form in which I choose to transmit the value. It would be interesting if I choose to pay you with cash and you refuse to accept the cash that I'm giving you. Some Slovenia dollar or something like that that you'd have to go to Slovenia to spend would not be acceptable to you. Which takes me to payment instruments, which is simply a device that enables the holder or the user to transfer value. Here at the Bank of Jamaica, we have responsibility for providing the economy with all the cash that is required to execute economic transactions. Those of us who work around the vaults of the Bank of Jamaica, I've learned over the years to recognize cash as just a piece of paper, and the real value of it is in its acceptability and the preparedness, the willingness of persons to accept cash in settlement of the obligations that we hold. Which provides me with an opportunity to speak a little about my perspective on financial services, and more specifically, mobile financial services. I think it's very, very important that as we get into those sort of discussions, we not lose sight of the fact that there is a device, and the device is simply a means of getting value transferred from one person to the other. There is a tendency for an overemphasis to high level of focus on the device and not on the characteristics which make payment or indeed the media as important as it is. There are some very, very prime examples of payment instruments, cash of course, checks, debit cards, credit cards are known to most, if not all of us in this room. The question is, what are the factors that should influence our choice of payment instrument? Most important, and I alluded to it just now, is the question of confidence. Both the payer and the payee must have confidence in the instrument that is being used. Most of us would prefer to get cash over anything else, assuming that the cash that we're receiving is not in too large an amount, because that is going to pose all sorts of risks to us. The cost of executing, or the cost that we will be incurring by using an instrument, is very, very important to us. The question of proximity goes to risk. If you're nowhere near me, I want to at least have some information about you and the instrument that you'll be using to settle your obligation to me. So the frequency, the priority, whether it's an immediate requirement, does the obligation have to be settled immediately, or can I recognize the fact that value has passed next week? Those are all very, very important factors in determining the choice of instrument. I specifically wanted to share those thoughts with you to make the point that as regulators and as payment system practitioners, one of our primary objectives must be to provide the Jamaican people, the Jamaican financial service consumer, with as wide a range of payment choices as possible. Irrespective of what transaction you're involved in, the nature of the business that you're involved in, there must be an appropriate cost-effective way of executing the payments to settle the obligations associated with your business, and that is a preoccupation of payment system overseers and indeed payment system regulators. A payment system, I've been using that term, what is it all about? A payment system facilitates the transfer of monetary value from the payer to the payee, and here are the characteristics are coming back again. The payment system is essentially comprised of a set of payment instruments, the procedures, the rules that facilitate the safety and efficiency of the transfer process, and by extension, the acceptability of the payment instrument that would be used. All of this goes to confidence. Confidence in the users of the system. Confidence that the users would have in the system. There are various types of payment systems, various ways of categorizing payment systems. For the purpose of this discussion, we'll just categorize payment systems in terms of the size of the value of the transfers that takes place in the systems. There are wholesale payment systems or large value payment systems, and then there are retail payment systems. Here in Jamaica, we started a reform process back in 2005 to ensure that we are served as a country by modern systems that meet international standards. And I'm pleased to say that We have had some significant accomplishments under that reform initiative. We are now served, Jamaica that is, now served by what is called Jan Clare Real-Time Growth Settlement System, which meets all current international standards. The Jan Clare system is our large value system. It allows for the financial institutions to pass large blocks of money between themselves each day to settle obligations one to the other. It also allows for government to execute its payment obligations throughout the economy in a very safe and efficient way. You can imagine debt payments that of necessity involve movement of large blocks of funds. Those are all settled in our large value payment system. And then there's a retail payment system. When you use your debit card, for example, you're using a retail payment system. This intersects with the discussion about financial inclusion, because not enough Jamaicans have access to the cost effectiveness, to the efficiency that the retail payment systems provide, and retail payment instruments, the availability of retail payment instruments, are not where they ought to be. I have not taken with me the information on debit cards, the number of debit cards that are in issue, number of credit cards and so on, but those are all bits of information that we monitor. That is a context in which there is discussion about mobile as an instrument, as a device that will provide an additional access point to the financial system by a larger proportion of the Jamaican consumer, and those discussions are continuing. It's important though that we recognize the mobile phone, the device, as just that, a device that will allow for the fundamental characteristics of a payment to be recognized and transformed in a manner that allows for economic transactions to be executed. Where do you fit? I think it's important to recognize that all of us are users of the payment system. Every single one of us, we might not have a savings account. We might not have deposits in a financial institution, but we all make payments. We have no choice but to make payments. And it seems to me, as we engage in this discussion about financial inclusion and financial literacy, I think it's important that we be very practical and start at the beginning by ensuring that something that every single one of us have to do on a daily basis, and in many instances several times per day, that the vast majority of the Jamaican people have access to the most efficient, the most cost-effective, the safest payment services available. And I think it's also important to recognize that a payment service customer today is not going to remain a payment service customer forever. You're going to be transitioning into savings products and credit and all the other banking services over time. There is more than sufficient evidence around the world to support that hypothesis. Payment service providers, who are they? Banks. I think it's important that we start recognizing remittance services and cambios and so on as part of the payment service. Quite a few of us pay our utility bills as one of the payment service providers. They are part of the landscape. And I've touched on the payment methods, the payment instruments. And the Bank of Jamaica, we have a responsibility at the base to ensure that all payment service customers, all of Jamaica, can retain confidence in the systems that are made available to us. Why payment systems matter? Payment systems support economic activity and economic management. They serve as vital element of the financial system infrastructure, serve as channels for monetary policy implementation, which a bank has responsibility for, and most importantly, promotes economic efficiency. Payment systems have become increasingly important to regulators and to central banks simply because of the significant increase in the volume of payments that are being executed electronically each day and the aggregate value of those payments over time. When you look at the tremendous increase in these numbers, it clearly suggests that if we're to promote financial system stability, if we're to promote confidence, consumer confidence, and confidence in how the economy is run and how economic activity is conducted, then we need to make sure that these channels are operating at the highest level of efficiency, but most importantly, are safe at all times. So, electronic payments, why are we interested in that? Sort of alluded to it earlier, safety and efficiency. Electronic payments will drive down the cost of executing payments, support increased levels of economic activities that demand faster and more reliable payment methods. Clearly, it will be impossible to do shopping on the internet using cash. Support financial inclusion, that's of critical importance, and I touched on that just now. Due to the continued technological innovation, we need not walk around with large volume of cash anymore. But of course, the use of technology in the payment space does not eliminate the need to satisfy all the critical or the essential characteristics of a payment. What it does is, if I might use an example, if I'm going to pay you by cash, then all the characteristics of a payment are right there in front of me, including the channel. The channel is my hand to your hand. When we separate the payer from the payee, and we separate the economic transaction from the settlement of the economic transaction, then those the immediate connection between those characteristics of a payment are disturbed. And that's where Bank of Jamaica and payment system regulators come in, because we need to make sure that the manner in which those characteristics are organized and executed does not undermine the confidence of the customers in the service. And that's where we come in. Why is BOJ interested? Continued confidence in the use of the payment system, ongoing safety and efficiency, and of course financial stability and fostering financial inclusion, very, very important to us. In a global sort of sense, the BOJ is very, very keen on pursuing some public policy objectives, some very, very important public policy objectives, not the least of which is the availability of a range of efficient and reliable electronic payment instruments to serve the largest proportion of the Jamaican people as possible. And most importantly, I'll just skip to the last one, to foster cost reduction through increased competition. What have we done so far? We're continuing our payment system reform program. I indicated earlier that we had designed, built, and delivered on the real-time gross settlement system. What is not known by most persons is that the Bank of Jamaica also designed, built, and delivered the Central Securities Depository, Jam Clear Central Securities Depository. Government no longer issue paper certificates to evidence borrowing from Jamaicans, all that is done in electronic form. And the cost reduction, the efficiencies, the risk management features that are attendant with that are just mind-blowing. We're very, very proud of that. We're now very, very involved in the next phase of the process, which is to get the retail payment system at the same level of effectiveness and efficiency. And in that regard, we issued earlier this year the electronic retail payment services guidelines. Already we have started to accept applications under those guidelines and processing those applications. A part of the reform agenda as well, we're working with the government, searching for ideas to promote electronic payment systems and government use of electronic payment systems. This morning I was very pleased to hear the minister make reference to the Central Treasury Management System, which we have been involved in working with the government on. I'm going to stop there. I'm going to conclude by reiterating a point I made earlier. One can survive without banking services, but one cannot survive in these modern economies without payment services. A payment service customer today will demand and be in need of banking and other financial services before long. I stop there, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Morrison. Another hand for Mr. Morrison, please, ladies and gentlemen. And now we'd invite a couple of questions before we move on to our next presentations. I should mention that they have no more prizes, but we are inviting you to come to St. William's Park tomorrow and Saturday, and there'll be lots of prizes and surprises then. So that's what I heard this morning, was just a teaser to let you know. Go ahead, please.
Schools. As a matter of fact, we just recently completed an exercise for the post-SCA students who are preparing to move on to secondary school, which has been extremely successful. 360 schools were reached, and the feedback coming from the students is that it has tremendously been informative for them and is going to be useful for them in future.
Yes, sir.
Yes, thank you. My question is on the what I call a predatory banking charges that is currently being operated by the commercial bank. So suppose the question goes to Bank of Jamaica. Just one situation where it is possible to have a savings account and it can be depleted by the bank by charges. If that is an approval by the Bank of Jamaica, we cannot make a note on this. On the central depository, the central security depository. Now, this has, you spoke about it glowingly. We move from a manual system of people buying bonds with the bank, people could walk in and do it. Now all the brokers, you have to go through brokers. So it is restricted. That means you're using less people to operate it. But you must pay a fee to use it. Now, what I have discovered
is through the electronic payment, or that the payment goes straight to the bank or the brokers. The payment is not automatically lodged to your account and be available. Right? I've discovered that recently. I wonder why. Because all of this is supposed to be automatic, making it flow. But you go to your broker, and your broker telling you, boy, you have to wait to latch it to your account. Because you get it in a bulk, and then somebody have to sit down and distribute it to his individual account.
That's two questions.
Well, just final one. And this is for the knowledge of what is this company, Caribbean Regional Technical Assistance Center. What somebody else could explain that company for them too.
Yeah, I think I'll start the first two, so maybe for Courtney, right? Come on, explain yourself for the third one.
Well, let me say thanks for those questions. The first one, whether the Bank of Jamaica approves predatory banking charges. Absolutely not. We don't. In fact, the Bank of Jamaica does not approve fees charged by banks. We have received several complaints, which we investigate from time to time. If there are instances where we think that persons have been disenfranchised, then we take that up with the institution. What we have been doing, though, is encouraging banking service customers to exercise their choice. You know, there are more than one financial institution operating in Jamaica, and you have every right to demand quality service at reasonable cost from each of your commercial banks operating in Jamaica. The second question had to do with having to access your investment in government paper through security dealers. That has not changed. It has always been that way, and the new system, the implementation of Jan Pierre CSD, has not changed that. And the second part of that question had to do with your payments. And the fact that there have been some delays in your accessing the payment through your broker. What you must be aware of, though, or should be advised about, is that Jan Pierre CSD allows for your broker to input all your banking information in the system so that the payments would automatically go to your account. That is to have the interest payments and your settlement proceeds go through the broker is a matter of choice. And that must be explained to you. It's something for you to discuss with your broker. You can provide all your banking data, which would allow for the payments to go directly to your banking account.
Just one final thing about the savings account. Now it's almost becoming compulsory for everybody to have a savings account. Government itself is carrying out payments through direct deposit to account. Now, if someone has like a $5,000 or $10,000 and it is there, there's a monthly charge being deducted from it. I don't think that somebody should have funds in a savings account and there is a possibility to end up with less. The first decide that they're not giving you interest at a certain amount, right? And that must be a policy of Bank of Jamaica, right? But even if they say that they are not giving you interest on their account, why should they be raiding their account?
They use of savings account to execute a number of these transactions is a function of the question that I raised earlier about choices. It goes to the heart of this question about financial inclusion and how we need to transition to another state of affairs that will allow not just savings account holders to have access to these services and these channels for accepting payments that are due to them, but other channels as well.
One second, please. I think Yada has one question as to what is CARTAC, and some people, others may have been wondering. In the interest of time, I had chosen all morning to say things like JDIC and CARTAC without spelling them out, or else we'd have been even later than we are. So, to tell us what CARTAC is a gentleman from CARTAC.
Okay, thank you, Tony. Now, CARTAC is a donor-funded organization that's located in Barbados. It's a Caribbean Regional Technical Assistance Center. And it's funded by the UK government, Australian government, Canadian government. The IMF provides resource to CARTAC, as well as the Caribbean Development Bank. We provide assistance to regional Caribbean government, the central banks, Financial Services Commission, Ministries of Finance, in several areas, including taxation, assistance on the building capacity, in public finance management, in financial sector, supervision and regulation, statistics, and other policy areas. So essentially, we work alongside these authorities in the different countries, and we are 20 member countries, including 8 in the Eastern Caribbean Currency Union. We go as far as Haiti, and Bahamas and Suriname, including, of course, you know, Barbados, Trinidad, Dominica, Guyana, etc. And we help to build the capacity in these authorities to ensure that you have, you know, sustainable infrastructure to continue in those areas of supervision or regulation or taxation.
Thank you very much, Courtney. So a couple more questions from our students.
My question is directed to Ms. Franklin. Have you seen any significant benefits from the financial literacy program in people's economic and financial decisions?
Okay, I was going to comment on that in some parts of my presentation, which I didn't have time to. I am not sure if I can answer it fully the way I want to. However, I can only tell you that based on our main tool to discover the impact of the program has been through evaluation of the process itself, feedback from our participants and from those who attend the sessions. And that is in the short term, because that is mostly targeted at the amount of knowledge that they have been able to, that has increased. So I can say for sure, in the short term, the knowledge of citizens have been increased in terms of a lot of citizens know now that they have to budget, and they also know that they cannot make mindless financial decisions. Financial decisions and choices are made on the basis of set goals. They are made on the basis of very serious calculations as to what the goals are to be achieved in that choice that has been made. So in that respect, we'll say citizens have that type of awareness at this time. In terms of the skills itself, we are just moving to that side of it, but basically we teach people to budget. We show them how they can set smart goals, and we also guide them with respect to the kind of financial products that they can use to be able to achieve the different financial goals. So to that respect, I would say in terms of knowledge, yes, there has been a lot of impact.
Thank you. Ms. Franklin's pamphlet today.
This question is directed to you. What propelled the Central Bank of Trinidad and Tobago to incorporate a financial literacy program?
Okay, like I tried to identify earlier on, there were serious concerns about the financial behavior and habits of the citizens. There was a period in which the economic growth of the country was quite high, and there was financial economic buoyancy. And people were open to a lot of opportunities that would have enable them to make wise financial decisions that will also help them to build their assets. However, they were not taking advantage of these opportunities. And so, you know, it became important that citizens ought to know that while we are making this money and we are getting economically, we have the advantages right now. It is important for us to capture some of these in terms of savings, in terms of investments, because economic conditions are not going to be permanent. Right now, as a matter of fact, there has been a contraction in the last 3 years, and you find that persons who earned high sums of income during those boom years actually have totally wiped out, and right now they're in dire economic conditions.
Thank you. Is this next question, Ms. Marcus? Okay. Go ahead.
Question to Dr. Nicholson. As you embarked on our financial literacy program,
Let me preface the answer to that question to say that I am from UEI, from the Mono School of Business and Management, but I do not speak on behalf of UEI. But what I know that there is no formal literacy program. What we know that the number of courses which are offered in finance, which are in economics and Mono School of Business and Management, actually would cover any of these areas that we talked about. With regard to a broad-based financial literacy program, the simple answer is no.
Is there any plan to do so in the near future, especially in the primary and secondary schools?
What I will do next time I have a conversation with the principal, I would raise this as an issue, and hopefully by then I should be able to answer definitively yes or no. But last time I checked, that question is way, way above my paycheck.
Last question before we move on.
Thank you very much. We've been talking a lot about financial inclusion, and we're talking about income and education being an area in which we basically use as a benchmark. But what about the persons who are in the other strata, persons who aren't in the high income? What about financial inclusion for them? What about the plans for the central government of Jamaica? Is there any plans that we have in place to ensure that persons at grassroots, as we like to say, are empowered and have the necessary skills, like the same program that has been implemented by the People's Republic of Trinidad and Tobago? Is there a means where we could get part of that program along with the findings of what some of what Dr. Nicholson been talking about, merge them together so that we could be able to have our own people who are in mass be able to better off, like for example, we have a financial rapid change. Is there any program that the Bank of Jamaica currently have or the Mona School of Business can work with to ensure that we have that sort of system here in Jamaica?
Did you follow Ms. Franklin from Trinidad?
Thank you.
A fact is that various entities, arms of government, have been involved in financial literacy program in different shape and form over a number of years. What is obvious is that there is need for a national effort, a coordinated effort. And already that discussion has started in the Bank of Jamaica. The governor, Governor Winter, is very passionate about this subject. And I'm confident that before the end of the year, the Bank of Jamaica will be deeply involved in coordinating a national effort towards financial inclusion.
Thank you very much, Mr. Morris. And now we move on, ladies and gentlemen. I think our next item is a dance number from Tivoli Dance Troupe, and this again was a gold medal winning number in our last national festival.
Conduct include